Dear colleagues, I will tell you about the modern status of the hypothesis for the evolutionary role of tumors. And you can't hear me? Channel 2. Why do we need new hypotheses and new paradigms? Maybe old hypotheses may be used? Channel 2. Professor Sverdlov, and I agree with him that the concept of molecular therapy as it exists has to be reconsidered. It comes out of the magic bullet concept that Ehrlich formulated more than 100 years ago, and we still are using it. We think that we may devise a magic bullet that will help us cope with all the problems. But it looks like this is not true. All the data in the sphere of oncology tell us that we can't conquer or eliminate tumors with magic bullets. Hence, we worked on a new hypothesis, and it is called the hypothesis of the evolutionary role of tumors. It says that the tumors provide space for revolution of new genes and new combination of genes. This concept was published in several books. I started formulating this hypothesis when I was a PhD student, and it took me several decades to develop it to the final form. Usually, as in molecular oncology, we use such diagrams with very high level of details. The question is, why do we need this evolutionary role of the tumors? But it turns out that this is a requirement to biological theories. Nothing in biology has a meaning except then from the point of view of evolution. And in fact, there are there's a whole list of characteristics in the tumors that might be used in evolution. And first and foremost, additional cellular masses are needed in the evolution of multicellular organism. Most probably stem cells take part in this process, but they are in regulatory and functional networks and they can't provide large cellular masses. Besides, tumors are characterized by very high biosynthetic potential and morphogenetic potential, which is needed for the evolution. This publication dates back to 16-something. That's the morphogenetic potential of a human being, to say nothing of simpler organisms. And there are some striking examples of the possible connection of tumors with the normal development processes. If you give such a slide to the oncologist and ask him to diagnose it, he will tell you papilloma. But in fact, these are the bugs, fetuses, and that's how their horns are being developed in the embryonal stage. So there was a theory that the tumors may develop from embryonic cells. And last year, actually, this theory was confirmed by studying the transcriptomes of the cells, kidney cells. And it turned out the transcriptomes of the kidney cells in children coincide with the transcriptomes from the tumors. And there are many similarities like this. And many people only ask the question why and how. these multiple similarities lead to the situation when tumors, on the one hand, are considered as atypical organs, on the other hand, there are tumor-like organs. What is this all about? It turns out that tumors, solid tumors, have a structure similar to normal organs. They have stroma, parenchyma, stem cells, and cells of higher differentiation. What differs them? The cells are differentiated improperly, and some links are violated. But the concept of tumor as atypical organs has been, or it has been accepted by many, but on the other hand, there are tumor-like organs, and these are placenta, breast, and prostate. Which features allow us to tell this? First and foremost, these organs are very young. Second, at least for breast and prostate, they have the higher incidence of tumors. The majority of women, for example, die from breast cancer, the majority of men from prostate cancer. All of these tumors have a stage of regulated invasiveness. And they co-evolution and they have co-expression of their organ-specific antigens. The system of organs is highly interconnected. Davis, in this Jamie Davis, have checked in her publication the correlation between the cancer incidence and the age of organs. And the younger the organs, like breast and prostates, the more incidence of cancers they have. And around 600 million years ago, this curve would go across the horizontal axis, meaning that at that time, the multicellular organisms did not have cancer. Davis did not explain why. She said, we'll have to think about the fact that the tumors play a role, but this is impossible. But we think that, yes, this is possible. We think that a typical tumor organs may turn into normal organs in the process of evolution. That's our hypothesis in brief. All hypotheses and theories are characterized by two requirements. They have toward non-trivial predictions and provide non-trivial explanations. We have a whole series of non-trivial predictions. Tumors have to be expressed into evolutionary new genes, number one. And the genes of tumor testicular antigens are evolutionary new for the human beings. I will skip some of them, but my colleagues after me will elaborate on these things I skip now. Let's look at the expressions in the evolutionary new genes. We have described about 10 genes. That's one of our favorites, PBOV1. This is one of two genes that for the first time was described for the human being as a de novo gene. Look at the features of the gene. It's a small gene, a one exome, single exome, sorry, quite short, no known domains, no known functions, an absolutely new gene. We speak about hydrogen instead of Asandi, so that's the same thing about the gene. But the patients with its expression are characterized with positive prognosis, so it must be playing certain role. And by the way, these data are confirmed like this. If Mark Lizard has confirmed two genes in a human being, our gene and another one. In other words, it is assumed that it may be a tumor suppressor of a kind. What is interesting for us, look at the expression of the gene. This is evolutionary new gene, but look at its expression. It is not being expressed in any of 36 normal panels. In all the tumors, around 26 tumors that were available to us. But this is striking for oncology, because usually the genes do not work in all the tumors, but this one does. Another gene like this, and look at its expression as well, also in all the tumors and in no norms. And the third gene is also expressed in all the tumors and in no norms. The three of them cover practically all the tumors. Out of 26 of the tumors we studied, they cover 23. A very interesting discovery. These are our opportunities, and they grow from day to day. We worked with 36 normal tissues as a control. Now, within the GTX database, 90 normal tissues are available. As for TCGA, about which Professor Willer told us, allow us to isolate 10,000 biosamples covering 33 different tumors. And similar transcriptomes may be now found in stem cells. When you We decided to compare them all, and look what we have come up with. With the help of a protein historian, we may isolate gene-specific genes in a human being, around 1,000 genes like this. New evolutionary genes of the human beings, different from chimpanzee. This is a fundamental amount, because in the old days they thought that we are not different from chimpanzees. But this regulatory theory of evolution shows that we do. And with the help of GTEx database with 90 normal tissues, we analyzed these 1,000-something genes, and it turned out that 365 genes with low or no expression do not work in normal tissues, while 200 are not expressed in stem cells. When we analyzed these 200 genes with TCGA, it turned out that 143 genes are expressed in most tumors, while 60 genes only in a few. It's a molecular revolution. These are principally new molecular reagents, which may become the basis of the diagnostics, a solution for therapy, etc. And that's how these arrays look. In gray, you see no expression in any normal tissues. And in white here, what is not expressed in stem cells. And we analyzed hundreds and hundreds of those. And now an example of another gene. What way has to be gone through from the moment we discover the gene and up to the clinical trials? Look, at some point, we carried out analysis, maybe one of the first analyses of this kind in the world, with all the known libraries. We developed the tools, and that's the results. 100% specificity, 90% specificity consequences. 21 clusters with 100% specificity. And then we analyzed its representatives. This was a Brachyury analog gene expressed in all the tumors, but not in normal tissues. This seemed to be quite interesting for the oncologists. We have applied for and received patents. As you see, I was a co-author. Russian and US patents, and then the publication. This patent has 16 clinical trials. That's a lot. And look, various companies use different modifications of this vaccine with a goal to generate a universal vaccine, because this gene is expressed in all the tissues. And the last clinical trial that has just been started, everything goes on in the US, is a combination of Brachyury with the checkpoint inhibitor. And the aim is to increase this 20%, because Brachyury is expressed in all tumors. First, Brachyury is taken, and then the checkpoint inhibitor turns them on, triggers them. This is one gene, and 15 years were needed for it to come to the second phase of clinical trials. We have now 15 genes, and I think we have to start with testing them all so that we have a whole battery on trial. And you understand that it is quite costly. Not only from the point of view of money, but also from the point of view of labor. But I hope we'll come up to that. And now we pass over to the prediction of the fact that cancer testicular genes we actually managed to prove this prediction of ours. Next prediction, endogenous retrovirus expression in connection with oncology shows different discrepancy. In one trial, in one study, they do express, in the other trials, they do not. And we assumed that this has to be connected with the evolutionary novelty of this infection. We've taken this slide from the Evgeny Sverdlov publication. The arrows show very well the different endogenous retroviruses infected the human genome in various times. The youngest is HERV-K60. The speaker after me will also repeat that the youngest endogenous retroviruses are expressed in the tumors, the older ones in the normal tissues. We may conclude that we have discovered a new biological phenomenon, evolutionary new genes that are expressed only in tumors. We call them CIN, or tumor-specifically expressed evolutionary novel genes. This is striking, and this can be used in oncology technologies. Now look at another prediction of ours that says the number of oncogenes has to be correlated to the number of cellular types in the organism. And look at the year when we made this prediction. 1987. 20 oncogenes were known in those days, but I predicted that they have to amount to 200, because we knew 200 cell types, and I assumed that if they correlate to the cell type in the organism, the oncogenes, I mean, the number has to numbers have to correlate as well. What do we have by now? 400 cell types, but not molecular cell types, because these are morphological classical cell types, and 245 oncogenes. We moved forward, and in the book, in my book, we see the evolution of oncogenes. I assume that they have to be, the evolution has to go in parallel. Andrei Makashov is going to tell you more about this work after my presentation. And these curves prove that the curves of evolution of these two really coincide. And this is a direct proof that oncogenes are connected with the new cell types. Well, Sergei Malov proved the trustworthiness and significance of this process. Another group of predictions, and you will hear more presentations. Alexander Emelianov will tell you about regression of tumors by switching off oncogene RAS-V1-2 oncogene. And Ekaterina Matinina will tell you about the induction of the tumor by activation of RAS-V1-2. This model may be used for both the induction and then regression. It resembles evolution, an organ that is in the process of evolution. I've shown this data several times. You see the goldfish cap. It's an organ, but very often it grows very much like a tumor. And Mark Zabizinski demonstrated that it was a benign hereditary tumor, papilloma-like. Conclusion out of this is that a benign tumor was selected in the course of millennia. And there are many examples like this. These are the examples of organs that develop from the tumors. We may conclude that our hypothesis on the tumor evolutionary role has a predictive power, which is very important. Now, what does it mean? Do we explode and damage the whole biology? No, we do not. That's the beginning of our theory, Karsina, Eva, Deva, and the other theories. So we are not inhibiting or damaging anything else, but we support them. For example, theory of progressive evolution doesn't explain the transition forms or the progressive evolution, but our theory helps and adds to other theories by explaining things they do not. That's how we explain transition forms, the organisms at various stages of progressive evolution. How this jump occurs? It does, but how? The genes come onto stage, but this is not sufficient. Transition forms haven't been found, but there is also a developmental constraints theory. Because it is not clear how the limitations connected with normal development are being overcome. How do we explain this? We say that transition form is tumor carriers population. And tumors at that are actually search engines. But in the computers, they search within the space of existing opportunities, while tumor search engines are searching in the space of unrealized opportunities.
I
I told you I'll explain the logic so of the novelty. Of these cancer testes, oncogenes, or cancer testicular oncogenes. I'm sorry, but the speaker is moving away from the microphone. So I can't hear everything. Something. Thank you. Where can we find evolutionary new genes? In the testicles. So for them to develop, the genes have to be expressed in the testicles, and we think that in the tumors. We started checking these genes, and we really showed that this class of genes was evolutionary new. Not one, not two of genes, but the whole class of cancer testis genes was evolutionary novel. Immunologists cannot explain the origin of adaptive immunity. They simply can't. It is considered that this is connected with transposon and duplication of genomes, which give all this give rise to adaptive immunity. But where did the cells come from? In amphibians, the structure of immunoglobulin locus is the same as in a human being, while the diversity of receptors and antibodies is much lower. Why? Because they lack cells. And the new cells for immunity is a non-trivial task. Maybe it is connected with the tumors. And tumors must take part in the new lymphoid structures and excessive cellular masses needed for clonal expansion and selection. Which other phenomena we do explain? Higher incidence of tumors in evolutionary novel organs. We, as human beings, have the so-called gammachorial placenta, the maximally invasive out of all the placentas. We explain this by the fact that placenta developed out of a tumor. And another interesting thing, breast cancer organogenesis means participation of adaptive immunity, the postnatal organogenesis. We explain this. And thus we come to the understanding of the thing that I call carcino eva deva. You know the eva deva teaching that was created by Severtsev and Schmargausen, the Russian scientists. It tells that not the mature organisms undergo evolution, but the whole ontogenesis. But we see that this evolution goes with the participation of the tumors. So I call this carcino eva deva. And look how it looks. Quite interesting. If we connect these symbols between themselves, we have such a diagram. The same as central dogma of the molecular biology. And this diagram is not only similar in appearance, but it also has a fundamental ban. You see, there's no reverse arrow here. Normal ontogenesis can't undergo evolution due to developmental constraint. And in order to undergo evolution, the normal ontogenesis has to have a transition form. And we think that this is a tumor carrier organism. Only in this way the evolution may take place. Look at the beautiful diagram. Deva 1 via carcinoma 1, and Eva 1 produces Deva 2, etc. And thus we have a spiral-like process that has been described already. It was Severtsev, our outstanding scientist from Russia, who first drew it. But we confirm it at a different level. What conclusion we may draw out of it? All the data that exists and I've told you about today prove that tumors may play a role in the evolution, and they really do. And hence, we have to change the tumor paradigm, not to try and kill the tumor with all the ways possible, but try to negotiate with them and come to terms with tumors. And the language in which we negotiate will be, or may be, the language of these novel oncogenes. Another conclusion is that we create new theory, which we call carcinoeva-diva, that has predictive power and explanatory power, and it can unite several other existing biology theories. Thank you.
Lecture is open for discussion now.
How theory correlates with the fact that we see a human being as an organism that has 10 bacterial cells per one human cell? I do not understand you, sorry. There is an understanding that a human being has 10 bacterial per each human cell. And the interaction between them is very close. So maybe we'll have to come to terms not only with our own genes and the oncogenes, but with the genome of the bacterial flora we coexist with. May I ask you to do me a favor? Everybody heard you via microphone, but I can't hear the microphone well. Can you repeat your question to myself? Absolutely right. The question is that a human being is a matter organism. But look, we discussed an example with endogenous retroviruses. That's an example. We also discussed one other example that I've shown here was the selection of papillomatosis, malignant papillomatosis in rodents that lead to normal macropapillomas that take part in the fermentation of fibers in the bowel of rodents in symbiosis with microbes. What is interesting that many tumors like this that become organs, they actually are a matter organism of a kind. For example, placenta, you know that placenta comes to life in the result of an infection of retroviruses. And these infections in various groups of mammals took place several times, as the genes are different. So things happen definitely and inevitably. Now look at another example, breast. The breast cancer is connected with endogenous and exogenous viruses that cause breast cancer in mice. This is not finally proven, but nevertheless, the viral trace is found there, or the beans nodules. There's also an example of symbiosis when external, maybe at first it was a pathogen, but then external pathogens started fixing nitrogen, became beneficial for the host, and symbiosis occurred and a new organ. That's really so. What about the placenta, the breast, and the pathos of our fight, of our work, is to save the human being? Alexei, what about protein products of evolutionary novel genes with folding? PBOV1 doesn't have any folding, by the way. It is so novel that it doesn't have domains or structures, but does it function? You have not been here. It doesn't have functions. KS, KS equals 1. That's actually the gene at the moment of birth that we managed to catch. And we caught many of those. I forgot to tell you that these 143 genes I've mentioned before are glycolyzed. Many of them are being expressed very well. And if we study them with the gene set enrichment analysis that allows to distribute these genes in terms of signal pathways, they do not belong to any signal pathways. With the method of gene oncology, if they are studied, they do not have organism functions. They must have some domains, but not major ones. And our task is, may I have my presentation back to the screen? The last slide, please. The very last slide. Here. So that's the last slide. The word therapy here actually replaces the word evolution. In the process of evolution, all these errors were reinforced and normal organs were formed. We have to do the same with the tumor, but with the word of therapy. But these genes do not have the function, any functions. So that's a kind of a paradox. And I think, Evgeny, we are moving towards the same thing, but from different sides. Maybe our approaches are complementary. We think that we have to reconsider our relations with a tumor. We have to say no to this magic bullet. But the concept we see as a therapy is also totally different, totally novel. The chemotherapy concept that is supported by large companies is becoming outdated. Look at metronome and adaptive therapy that now come onto stage, bringing down the concentration, modulation of concentration with the monitoring and track and tracing of the tumor, which proves that chemotherapy, to say nothing of immunotherapy, are now under criticism. But we move even forward. We say that we have to consider some evolutionary things. David said that mutations do not give us that much. We need to conduct transcriptome analysis. And Dr. Bogenura also showed us this. We also analyze transcriptomes and look which interesting things we find that have never been described before. Biotechnology task nowadays is to analyze these 150 genes that exist in all the tumors. This proves that the universal preventive anti-tumor vaccine is a possibility, and that's what we have to deal with. Thank you.
Dr. Kozlov, I have one. Have you looked to see whether these genes are upregulated through amplification in the genomes of the various tumors? Through amplification. Are these genes present in any amplified portions of any of the cancer genomes?
The difficulty is that we have lots of genes. We are trying to work with the whole population, but it's very difficult to deal with individual genes.
Скажите, пожалуйста, насколько гетерогенные эти гены по популяции. Вот если сравнивать индивидуум за индивидуумом, насколько они гетерогенны?
Я боюсь, я не могу на этот вопрос ответить, потому что...
Sorry, how heterogeneous are those genes in the population? I can't, sorry, answer this question. We have the data in bulk. They are not segregated in terms of various patients, but this is a possibility because there are 10,000 transcriptomes existent, and we can demonstrate this. The data we have as of today, they are not representative, but the difference is present. They are not universal and universally expressed everywhere. I think this deserves your attention because heterogeneity in a population confirms the ability to evolution. The higher the heterogeneity, the higher this ability. And if many individuals won't be having a certain gene, maybe this gene is not needed. Certainly, when I showed you the population of tumor carriers, certainly it is restricted, not all the organisms of this species. This is some population or heterogeneity you mentioned, and it is clear that in this population, this is a population with high level of cancer, and differentiation processes have to take place there quite often. That's the heterogeneity that we'll have to study. You are right.